This is a course in miracles. It is your path of enlightenment. It is your journey without distance in the space of an instant of reality. It is a required course. Only the time you take it is voluntary. Free will does not mean that you can establish the curriculum. It means only that you can elect what you want to take at a given time. This course does not aim at teaching the meaning of love, for that is beyond what can be taught. It does aim, however, at removing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence, which is your natural inheritance. The opposite of love is fear, but what is all-encompassing can have no opposite. This Course in Miracles can therefore be summed up very simply in this way. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. When you are fearful, you are non-existent. In truth, this fearful world does not exist at all. Herein lies the peace of God. This Course in Miracles presents the inevitable possibility of the eternal singular reality of life. Now to the practice of the transformation of your mind. This, the workbook of A Course in Miracles. A theoretical foundation, such as was presented in the text, is necessary as a framework to make the exercises that we now intend to begin meaningful. Yet it is doing the exercises that will make the goal of the course possible. An untrained mind can accomplish nothing. This workbook, this provision of training that you are undertaking, is divided into two main sections. First, we're going to deal with the undoing of the way that you see now, and second, with the acquisition of true perception. Here is our purpose. The purpose in what we will perform on this video and in this workbook is to train your mind in a systematic way to a different perception of everyone and everything in the world. Listen, transfer of training in true perception does not proceed as does transfer of the training of the world. If true perception has been achieved in connection with any person, situation, or event, total transfer to everyone and everything is certain. On the other hand, one exception held apart from true perception makes its accomplishment anywhere impossible. The very nature of true perception is that it has no limits. It is the opposite of the way that you see now. In this practice that we are about to begin, some of the lessons you will find hard to believe, and others may seem to be quite startling. This does not matter. You are merely asked to apply the ideas as you are directed to do. You are not asked to judge them at all. You are asked only to use them. It is their use that will give them meaning to you and will show you that they are true. Remember only this, you need not believe the ideas, you need not accept them, and you need not even welcome them. Some of them you may actively resist. None of this will matter or decrease their efficacy. The only thing we ask is that you don't make any exceptions on a moment-by-moment basis as you apply these lessons of this Course in Miracles. Here now begins the mind training. Thanks for inviting me to come and sit with you once again. Those of you who have been sharing with me this Course in Miracles, the idea that through a systematic program, we can change our conceptual selves in relationship to a new truth that we are discovering based on our certainty of a self-awareness that transcends our previous objective associations with ourselves. We call it the Workbook of A Course in Miracles because the provision for the solution to the evidence of you as a human being without a cord as to a real alternative as to why you would be here occupying this body in this little place of space-time is offered to you as a complete alternative to how you have previously expressed yourself. And based on the calls that we're getting now, and they're up into the thousands, the application of this mind training, the idea that in the privacy of your own association with yourself, that is, whether you're out in the world performing all of the obstacles to your existent self-identity, you begin to have an experience of this alternative. Now, the basis of what I'm offering you on this, I believe this is number 6 or number 7, it's proceeding from the beginning of the workbook of A Course in Miracles, and certainly at this point in my address with you when you came into this circumstance, my inquiry to you would be, are you beginning to have this experience of the enlightenment of your own mind, since the procedure of the miracle occurrence must involve the transformation of you coming from this space-time episode, okay, into a moment of reality that then becomes a whole part of what you are in space-time. Those of you who perhaps are seeing this video and have never and haven't seen any of the preceding ones or are not aware of what A Course in Miracles is, A Course in Miracles, okay, is a message from out of time, from God, through your historic Savior, Jesus Christ, telling you a manner in which you can recognize the wholeness of you in relationship with eternal life. So your presence here now is an indication that somewhere you have become willing to release the objective identity that you brought with you when you came into this practice. We have a custom of going back and showing the first 7 lessons of this mind training, ending with lesson number 7 that says, you are seeing only the past. It may give you a better perspective as to how I, with my present mind, view you. Let's watch it. I see only the past. This idea is particularly difficult to believe at first, yet it is the rationale for all of the first 6 lessons that we practice and is the beginning point to a step out of time. It is the reason why nothing that you see means anything. It's the reason why you have given everything you see all the meaning that it has. It is the reason why you do not understand anything you see. It's the reason why your thoughts do not mean anything and why they are like the things that you see, as meaningless as are you. It's the reason why you're never upset for the reason that you think. That it's the reason why you're upset because you see something that is not there. All because you see only the past. Old ideas about time are very difficult to change because everything you believe is rooted in time and depends on your not learning these new ideas about it. Yet that is precisely why you need new ideas about time. this first-time idea is not really so strange at all if you look at it. Look at this cup. Do you see a cup, or are you merely reviewing your past experience of picking up a cup, being thirsty, drinking from a cup, feeling the rim of a cup against your lips, having breakfast, and so on? Are not your aesthetic reactions to the cup, too, based on past experiences? How else would you know whether or not this kind of cup will break if you drop it? What do you know about this cup except what you learned in the past? You would have no idea what this cup is except for your past learning. Do you then really see it at all? Look about you. This is equally true of whatever you look at. Everything that you see is always over and gone. Each moment in all of time, you exist in the entirety of this space, here and now. Now let's catch up to some very late time. My mind is preoccupied with past thoughts. I see nothing as it is now. My thoughts do not mean anything. My meaningless thoughts are showing me a meaningless world. I'm upset because I see a meaningless world. A meaningless world engenders fear. God did not create a meaningless world. My thoughts are images that I have made. I have no neutral thoughts. I see no neutral things. I am not alone in experiencing the effects of my seeing. I am not alone in experiencing the effects of my thoughts. I am determined to see. I am determined to see things differently. What I see is a form of vengeance. I can escape from the world I see by giving up my attack thoughts. I do not perceive my own best interests. I do not know what anything is for. My attack thoughts are attacking my invulnerability. Above all else, I want to see. Above all else, I want to see things differently. God is in everything I see. God is in everything I see because God is in my mind. I am not the victim of the world I see. I have invented the world I see. There is another way of looking at the world. I could see peace instead of this. My mind is part of God's. I am very holy. My holiness envelops everything I see. My holiness blesses the world. There is nothing my holiness cannot do. My holiness is my salvation. I am blessed as a son of God, and God goes with me wherever I go. So does that seem reasonable to you? Is it possible for you right now, having just looked at those first seven lessons, and we showed a sequence of the lessons that have led us up to the lessons for today, which will be 42, 43, 44, and perhaps 45. Now, if you can look with me at the reasonableness of the idea that the aggregation of your conceptual thoughts were always manifestations of the old organization of your mind, and that I am offering you, in a literal sense, the light of an alternative based on my certainty of a singular mind. This is what this course in miracles, the training, the mind training, must show you: the difference in what you thought you were and what you are now recognizing that you are becoming. Without that, what would be the purpose in the miracle? The difficulty that you encounter in your concepts of yourself is my certainty that the concepts that you now hold of yourself are not true, and were never true. So I have asked you, in this procedure of transformation of your mind, to admit very simply that as you came into this organization of my attempts as what you call an advanced teacher, to show you a complete alternative to what you thought you were as a human being, you have an inherent resistance to it, because you are the inherent resistance. Your conceptual self as identified by you in the particulars of the objective relationship with yourself are what are preventing you from seeing this complete alternative of love that I'm offering you. We begin with religious ideas that if who you thought you were is not true, it must be that the complete alternative of a single creative source, God, not as identified by you, but in the certainty that you cannot be separate from him in the accord as you walk around in this dark form of space-time. The lesson that we offered at the end of the last video that we did said very simply that God goes with you wherever you go. So he's always available to you in the entirety of your relationship with eternal life. Just for a moment, let's take a quick look at how we ended the last video. This will be lesson 41. God goes with me wherever I go. Watch. And now here's a key lesson 41. God goes with me wherever I go. Today's idea will eventually overcome completely the sense of loneliness and abandonment all the separate ones experience. Depression is an inevitable consequence of separation. So are anxiety, worry, a deep sense of helplessness, misery, suffering, and intense fear of loss. The separate ones have invented many cures for what they believe to be the ills of the world. But the one thing they do not do is to question the reality of the problem. Yet its effects cannot be cured because the problem is not real. The idea for today has the power to end all this foolishness forever. And foolishness it is, despite the serious and tragic forms it may take. Deep within you is everything that is perfect, ready to radiate through you and out into the world. It will cure all sorrow and pain and fear and loss because it will heal the mind that thought these things were real and suffered out of its allegiance to them. Listen, you can never be deprived of your perfect holiness because its source goes with you wherever you go. You can never suffer because the source of all joy goes with you wherever you go. You can never be alone because the source of all life goes with you wherever you go. Nothing can destroy your peace of mind because God goes with you wherever you go. At last, you're starting to believe. The truth was hidden deep within, under a heavy cloud of insane thoughts, dense and obscuring, yet representing all that you see. Today, now at last, we're going to go beyond and make our first real attempt to get past this dark and heavy cloud and to go through it into the light beyond. Most of all, try to sink down and inward, away from the world and all the foolish thoughts of the world. You are trying to reach past all of these things. You are trying to leave appearances and approach reality. It is quite possible to reach God. In fact, it is very easy because it is the most natural thing in the world. You might even say it's the only natural thing in the world. The way will open if you believe that it is possible. This exercise can bring very startling results even the first time it's attempted. And sooner or later, it's always successful and it's beginning to work in you now. So here we are. We're back once again. That's rather a dramatic demonstration of your evolved certainty that as a separate one, all the cures you have invented for the depression and loneliness and loss of the things that you love, that you feel, aren't real. They're momentary containments of an historic reference that you hold about yourself in space-time. And the idea of a simultaneous correction, the idea that at any single moment, since none of your conceptual associations with yourself are real, you may and are, hopefully, undergoing an entirety of an experience of an alternative that will make you very happy. And you know why it'll make you happy? Because it's who you really are. Those of you who haven't had a chance to see the offering that I am giving you, and I want to assure you that I'm giving to you right now, my certainty of who I am through my realization, through my illumination of mine, is offering you my certainty of your whole mind. Now, the reason that that is possible and certain in my mind is I am certain of who I am in my relationship with eternal life, or with what you call God. I cannot not be certain of that because myself is who I will be regardless of how I am being asked to view the world that I previously entertained as a possibility for life. Okay? This is not life. The entrapment that you have been experiencing in this dream of death, in the idea that you would be confined to this dark form energy of what we term light or power of mind, which is God, is not true. What I am offering you through this Course in Miracles is very simply more light into your conceptual self than you have previously been willing to express. And you know what? It's starting to work. You know why? It cannot not work. Any idea of a transition from time, from space, to an eternal reality, not objected to by anything since it's a creative source of who you are, cannot not come about, and it's coming about at your direction of a search for a solution somewhere out in the world. Suddenly I'm with you within your own mind and I'm telling you the solution is not out in the world, since the world is a construction, okay, of your denial of who you are in eternal life. Many of you now have come to the realization that you were living a mistake. The idea of sin, the idea that you could suffer pain and death and be lonely and lose the things that you love is not true. You were mistaken about who you thought you were. It's not true that you can get old and you can get sick and you can die. You are not a body. You are whole in the love that I am sharing with you right now in our realization that we share that mind of love and wholeness. So you've come a long way. I know when you're out in the world now, suddenly one of the lessons is beginning to appear to you in your own mind. And it really wasn't necessary that you recognize the relationship of what you were offered, because the truth of what you really are cannot be known to you in your conceptual associations. What we're going to do now is offer, after God goes with me everywhere I go, we're going to offer you a continuing active, meditative idea about a solution to your conceptual conflict that is always available to you. And these will be lessons 42, God is my strength, vision is his gift, God is my source and I can't see apart from him, and that God is the light with which I see. What it's actually offering you is the certainty, all right, that all power, as Jesus, our Savior, would say, is given unto you in heaven and earth. That power will describe itself in space-time as light, since light is an energy factor of the strength of God. the admission in lesson 43 that you can't think apart from him, which will be matured in 45, simply gives you the entire indication that you are the source of all reality. Okay? And that the light of God's mind is the light that is showing you alternatives, not based on the limited form of the light that identified your body's eyes, but in the acceptance of what previously was conflictual to you in your mind, you begin to see the conversion of the bright form without the necessity to resist it within your own mind. Let's share together then just a moment about perhaps what you will think are attributes of eternal life or the mind of God. But in my certainty of who I am is my certainty that these thoughts will represent you. Watch. Let's take a look at some of the qualities of God now that I know are a part of me and a part of you. Lesson number 42 says that God is my strength and vision is his gift. The idea for today combines two very powerful thoughts, both of major importance. It also sets forth a cause and effect relationship that explains why you cannot fail in your effort to achieve the goal of this Course in Miracles. You will see because it is the will of God. It is his strength, not your own, that gives you power. And it is his gift, rather than your own, that offers vision to you. God is indeed your strength, and what he gives is truly given. This means that you can receive it anytime and anywhere, wherever you are, and in whatever circumstances you find yourself. Your passage through time and space is not at random. You cannot but be in the right place at the right time. Such is the strength of God. Such are his gifts. There is no limit on the number of short practice periods that would be beneficial for today's lesson. The idea for today is a beginning step in bringing thoughts together and teaching you that you are studying a unified thought system in which nothing is lacking that is needed, and nothing is included that is contradictory or irrelevant. That's lesson 42. God is my strength, and vision is his gifts. On now to lesson 43. God is my source. I cannot see apart from him. Perception is not an attribute of God. His is the realm of knowledge. Yet he has created the Holy Spirit as the mediator between perception and knowledge. Without this link with God, perception would have replaced knowledge forever in your mind. With this link with God, perception will become so changed and purified that it will lead to knowledge. This is its function as the Holy Spirit sees it. Therefore, that is its function in truth. Listen, in God you cannot see. Perception has no function in God and does not exist. Yet in salvation, which is the undoing of what never was, perception has a mighty purpose. Made by the Son of God for an unholy purpose, it must become the means for the restoration of his holiness to his awareness. Perception has no meaning. Yet does the Holy Spirit give it a meaning very close to God's. Healed perception becomes the means by which the Son of God forgives his brother and thus forgives himself. You cannot see apart from God because you cannot be apart from God. Whatever you do in him, because whatever you think with his mind. If vision is real, and it is real to the extent to which it shares the Holy Spirit's purpose, then you cannot see apart from God. Let's take just a couple of minutes now and glance around, shall we, with the idea that God is your source and that you cannot see apart from Him. You might want to try to repeat, as it shows in the lesson book, that you see through the eyes of forgiveness, that you see the world as blessed, and say to yourself, the world can show me myself if I will let it. Or I see my own thoughts, which are like God's. I can't see anything that I view out in this world apart from God, because my mind is a part of God's. This holds true with whoever you meet today, doesn't it? When you are with someone else, for example, try to remember to tell him quietly, God is my source. I cannot see you apart from Him. This form is equally applicable to strangers as it is to those you think are closer to you. In fact, try not to make distinctions of this kind at all. Okay? Today's idea should also be applied throughout the day to various situations and events that may occur, particularly to those which seem to distress you in any way. Simply say, God is my source. I cannot see this apart from Him. From God is my source, we move to lesson 44, that God is the light in which I see. Today we are continuing the idea for yesterday, and we're adding another dimension to it. Listen, you cannot see in darkness, and you cannot make light. You can make darkness and then think you see it, but light reflects life and is therefore an aspect of creation. Creation and darkness cannot coexist, but light and life must go together, being but different aspects of creation. In order to see, you must recognize that light is within, not without. You do not see outside yourself, nor is the equipment for seeing outside yourself. An essential part of this equipment is the light that makes seeing possible. It is with you always, making vision possible in every circumstance. Now listen, today we are going to attempt to reach that light. For this purpose, we will use a form of exercise which has been suggested before and which we will utilize increasingly. It is a particularly difficult form for the undisciplined mind and represents a major goal of mind training. It requires precisely what the untrained mind lacks. Yet this training must be accomplished if you are to see. Your mind is no longer wholly untrained. You are quite ready to learn the form of exercise we will use today. But you may find that you will encounter strong resistance. The reason is very simple. While you practice in this way, you leave behind everything that you now believe and all the thoughts that you have made up within yourself. Properly speaking, this is the release from hell. Yet perceived through the ego's eyes, it is the loss of identity and a descent into hell. If you can stand aside from the ego by ever so little, you will have no difficulty in recognizing that its opposition and its fears are meaningless. You might find it helpful to remind yourself from time to time that to reach light is to escape from darkness, whatever you may believe to the contrary. God is the light in which you see. You are attempting to reach that light beginning now. While no particular approach is advocated for this form of exercise, what is meaningful is a sense of the importance of what you're doing. Its inestimable value to you and an awareness that you are attempting something very holy. Salvation is your happiest accomplishment. It is also the only one that has any meaning, because it is the only one that has any real use to you at all. If you're doing these exercises correctly, and many of you are now along with me on this video, you should begin to get a feeling that you're approaching, if not actually entering, into the light. There. Try to think of light, formless and without limit, as you pass by the thoughts of this world, and do not forget that they cannot hold you to the world unless you give them the power to do so. So here we are together now, admitting that we are entering into the light, because God is the light in which I see. How very bright you are beginning to become now in this association with yourself. Okay? So the message that God is the light with which you see, and the strength with which you represent yourself, and the source from which you come, have offered you within your own conceptual idea of yourself a complete alternative based on the transformation of your mind to what you thought you were. You remember in the last video, number 6 that we did, we offered you our certainty that when you came into this setting with me, your conceptual mind was in an avoidance of the place and time that I am offering you. Those of you who have watched the other videos are aware that as you begin to share with me this experience, the fear of your encounter with the light of God, which is actually what you are, okay? Remember when you saw number 43, whatever it was, it says you cannot see in darkness, and you cannot make light, because you believe that you live in objective dark form associations. You think that you can make light out of the ideas of the potential of your conceptual mind. It's impossible, because the moment you convert the particle, the idea of separation within what you call the potential of your thought forms, you can only become the light that you already are. You suffer from a condition known as sequential time, where you continue to convert your own historic references of yourself to alternatives that are always based on past events. You become accustomed to the idea that life is what this is. Okay? You're here because you really, up to this point, have actually believed that you could get old and suffer pain and die, and you call that life. Okay? Even though you searched for another solution, okay, within that frame, in your desperation to see how you could possibly be separate from eternal life. The simple truth of the matter is, you're not separate. All you had to accept from my mind, which is your mind in light, since I am an aspect of your dream association with yourself, was that this world is not real. Having come to that conclusion momentarily in your mind, you feel the joy of not having to continue to operate in a procedure of relationship of sequential time that can only bring you the inevitable result of what it has always brought you, which is what? Death. In a particular way, and I'm going to talk about it for a moment, what I've offered you is a continuing release of the defense of yourself from death. The great apostle Paul, who underwent his Damascus experience, we'll go to Christianity for a moment, always and continually expressed in his epistles the certainty that he died each day. And he offered to the Christians his certainty that the conceptual Saul had nothing to do with the realization of Paul that emerged at the time that Jesus spoke to him. How did he practice this in his own mind? Every time, and this is true of this course for you, every time you find a correspondence in what you think this life is, it's a resistance to your inevitability to die. Are you ready with this now, what I'm offering you? I want to bring you to the spot in your own mind where you experience, okay, what you would term the impossibility of the situation in which you find yourself. Because at that moment in space and time, the complete alternative will be available to you. If you can accept fundamentally from me what I'm going to say to you now, you can begin to have a very dramatic experience of an alternative. All you have to accept from me is that everything contained within your conceptual self is an idea about who you are. It must be then, if you are a conceptual justification within this very small dark frame, that you have an idea of death in your own mind, okay? What you're going to have to look at with me, okay, in a very fundamental conceptual sense, the idea of death, okay, is what this life is. If I can get you to look at it with me for just a moment, you'll see that everything that you do from the time you come into this world is based on the inevitability that you're going to get old and sick and die, and I'm threatening you with an alternative that would show you that is not true. And you say to me, well, how is eternal life a threat to me? How is eternal life and the idea that Jesus resurrected, how can that be a threat to me? It's a threat to you because you are depending on death, longevity within your own mind to justify the association of what you think you are. I'm going to take about 4 minutes, if you'll let me. Let me take about 4 minutes, and I'm going to show you a lesson that occurs a little bit later on in the workbook. And it says very simply that there is one life and that we share with God. And it's going to contain in it the necessity for you to deny your idea of death. Okay, your idea of death is that you will live in the body, proceed to occupy yourself in this hydrogen, oxygen, what we call the nitrogen cloud, and then die. Not true. You've accepted from me the fundamental idea that this is not life. If this is not life, then you must in fact be dead at this moment. Jesus, when he describes this in the New Testament, says, I'm going to heal the sick, and I'm going to raise you from death, which is nothing but the fundamental idea that you could be separate from eternal life. There's one life, and that I share with God, and we'll just watch a small portion of it. But contained within it will be the condition that you are actually in regard to what you thought you were. Watch with me. This is lesson 167. There is one life, and that I share with God. There are not different kinds of life, where life is like the truth. It does not have degrees. It is the one condition in which all that God created share. Like all his thoughts, it has no opposite. There is no death, because what God created shares his life. There is no death because an opposite to God does not exist. There is no death because the Father and the Son are one. In this world, there appears to be a state that is life's opposite. You call it death. Yet we have learned that the idea of death takes many forms. It's the one idea which underlies all feelings that are not supremely happy. It's the alarm to which you give response of any kind that is not perfect joy. All sorrow, loss, anxiety, suffering, and pain, even a little sign of weariness, a slight discomfort, or the merest frown, acknowledge what? Death. And thus deny that you live. You think that death is of the body, yet it is but an idea, irrelevant to what is seen as physical. A thought is in the mind. It can be then applied as mind directs it, but its origin is where it must be changed if change occurs. Ideas leave not their source. The emphasis this course has placed on that idea is due to its centrality in our attempts to change your mind about yourself. It's the reason that you can heal. It is the cause of healing. It is why you cannot die. Its truth established you as one with God. We share one life because we have one source. A source from which perfection comes to us, remaining always in the holy minds which he created perfect. As we were, so are we now and will forever be. A sleeping mind must waken as it sees its own perfection, mirroring the Lord of life so perfectly it fades into what is reflected there. And now it is no more a mere reflection. It becomes the thing reflected and the light which makes reflection possible. No vision now is needed, for the awakened mind is one that knows its source, itself, and its holiness. So, it's the reason you can heal. It's the reason why you can raise the sick and the dead, very simply because there's only one life and you share it with God. It's interesting that in that lesson, there's an acknowledgement that your fundamental condition, is death. I remember, and most of you can, as young children, we're taught to exist in this form, begin to protect yourself, from things that were outside of you, so you could believe that you could actually come here, and you would find this world here, and you could struggle with it, and it was always and continually a demonstration of the idea that you could die. Remember what it said? The idea of death takes many forms. Anxiety, fear, despair are expressions of death, not of life. Once more, the expressions that have hounded you, and this is the hounds of heaven that are pursuing you, have hounded you in the idea that you must defend yourself from eternal life, are nothing but manifestations of your determination to stay in this little form of sequential time and die. Now, these lessons of this Course in Miracles in mind training are showing you that the greatest threat that you could ever experience anywhere in time is the basic idea of eternal life, which is what I am certain that you are in my mind, and you cannot not be certain in your mind, since there is one life, and we share that with God. Is that so? So what I'm offering you now is a whole new mindfulness of what you are, based on the releases of your defenses, which protect you, not from life, but from death. You are protecting yourself, in your need to demonstrate your capacity to die. And it won't work. Is it all right if I tell you this? It's not going to work. Do you really think that I would be what you term an advanced teacher, sitting with you in an illumination of my mind, and allow you to tell me that I'm some old guy, that I'm an old, what was it, World War II vet, that I'm in my 70s, and that I'm struggling within my body to maintain some sort of dignity as I get old and suffer pain and death? You want to look at me for just a minute? Huh? Look at me. Do you actually believe that I'm going to accept your judgment of what you think I am just because you can look back in my historic record along with your own in order to prove that my life is going to be a cycle from a long time ago, okay, on up through all of the drama that I played in my own mind in my attempt to find a solution from this, and you expect me to accept your identity of me? Let's not be absurd. I'm offering you a solution within your own mind that of my certainty through my illumination that I am not a body. I don't know how far this is going to go, but I want you to see it with me now. All right? I will not accept the verdict that you are laying on me, old ones, in regard to what you think I am. And I won't accept it because I have freed my mind of the idea that I would be locked in this association. I'm not locked, I'm free. I'm not a body. I'm whole as God created me. This is fanciful, it's ridiculous, and you're not going to accept it. And you know why? Because you maintain a reflection from your own memory source that condemns me to a relationship with you in what you think you are. Okay, you must somewhere within this procedure understand that what I'm offering you is not what you thought you were. What I'm showing you is a direct communication at this place and in this time that is not of the body at all. Okay? Instantaneous communication does not involve what you thought you were and what you insisted that I'm going to be, because I am not who you thought I was. Okay? I'm also not who I thought you were. Okay? I'm not going to share with you the little enclosures that justify our separation. I'm going to release the defense of my identity. I've now had an experience of an enlightenment that shows me I can't get old and I can't get sick and I can't die. What I'm curious about is, wouldn't you want this to be true? The fundamental teaching of A Course in Miracles says very simply that you're not a body and you can't get old and you can't die. All you really had to say to me as a so-called advanced teacher is that you want it to be true. Would you like to have it be true that I am certain that I am not a body and that I'm expressing to you within your own dream sequence a whole idea of what we're going to share as we depart this world at this moment and in this time? Look what these lessons of this course have brought about in you. Okay. The dramatic demonstration through our love for each other at this moment in time that we are whole and perfect as God created us. The mind training is working, and the new you, the metamorphosis of what you term the species, Homo sapien, whatever you thought the transition of your consciousness was, the insane idea that you wouldn't know who you are is ridiculous. And it's become so ridiculous in your own mind, obviously not knowing who you are is what death is. Okay, remember what we saw, that there was one life and that we share with God. You are coming through this training to know who you are. And it's inevitable that it will occur, because it did occur. Each moment you have been reliving this single moment when the idea of time or death could take the place of the eternal life that you must be. So death was an idea that no longer has value to you, and I want you just for a moment to renounce it with me now. Okay? There is no death. I'm looking right at you. I'm going to show you the bright alternative that's available to you. You know why it's available? We're going to look at one more lesson here before we wrap this up. as dramatic and as impossible as it may appear to be to you. God is the mind with which you think, okay? And that's what we're going to watch right now, because it will prove to you in a moment of revelation what you really are. Let's watch it together. Now let's take a look at what is the foundation for everything that we have been trying to present to you in regard to the operation of your mind. Key lesson number 45, God is the mind with which I think. Today's idea holds the key to what your real thoughts are. They are nothing that you think you think, just as nothing that you think you see is related to vision in any way. There is no relationship between what is real and what you think is real. Nothing that you think are your real thoughts resemble your real thoughts in any respect. Nothing that you think you see bears any resemblance to what vision will show you. Listen, you think with the mind of God. Therefore, you share your thoughts with Him as He shares His with you. They are the same thoughts because they are thought by the same mind. To share is to make alike or to make one. Nor do the thoughts you think with the mind of God leave your mind, because thoughts do not leave their source. Therefore, your thoughts are in the mind of God as you are. They are in your mind as well where He is. As you are part of His mind, so are your thoughts also part of His mind. Where then are your real thoughts? Today we'll attempt to reach them. We will have to look for them in your mind, because that is where they are. They must still be there, because they cannot have left their source. What is thought by the mind of God is eternal, being part of creation. We will attempt to leave the unreal and seek for the real today. We will deny the world in favor of truth. We will not let the thoughts of the world hold us back. We will not let the beliefs of the world tell us that what God would have us do is impossible. Instead, we will try to recognize that only what God would have us do is possible. We'll also try to understand that only what God would have us do is what we want to do. And we will also try to remember that we cannot fail in doing what He would have us do. There is every reason to feel confident that we will succeed today, because it is the will of God. My real thoughts are in my mind, and I want to find them. Under all the senseless thoughts and mad ideas with which you have cluttered up your mind are the thoughts that you thought with God in the beginning. They are there in your mind now, completely unchanged. They will always be in your mind exactly as they always were. Everything you have thought since then will change, but the foundation on which it rests is wholly changeless, and you have found that foundation here and now. It is this foundation toward which the exercises for today are directed. Here is your mind joined with the mind of God. Here are your thoughts one with His. For this kind of practice, only one thing is really necessary. Listen, approach it as you would an altar dedicated in heaven to God the Father and to God the Son. For such is the place you are trying to reach. It may be very possible for you now to realize how high you are really trying to go. New understanding that you're gaining now in these mind training videos and with these mind training lessons are reminding you that this is no idle game, but an exercise in holiness and an attempt to reach the kingdom of heaven. At some point, as this light begins to shine on you and you recognize that you are using the power of God, you might want to add, thank you, God. Thank you for these lessons that you have given me. Thank you for your Son, my Savior, Jesus, who through his direction has shown me the light that I now feel in recognition of my true self and you as the light of my world. There's an element, and I'm going to share this with you just for a minute, because I know you're at the point where you have beginning to recognize who you really are. It's impossible that at this time you do not begin to express gratitude. Okay? Very simply, thank you. Okay. The idea that you would be willing to forgive what I am offering you cannot not be a procedure that showed you that all of the existent identity you held about yourself was not true. So in that sense, this is an intervention into the conflict that you have felt within your own mind. Can you see this with me? I want you to see this with me. The reason you should be grateful for this procedure is that in a literal sense, you didn't have anything to do with it whatsoever. Look around this world. Everything that is being performed in this world in relationship to an idea of a conclusion that can be reached in your own mind always only gave solutions in correspondence with one illusion versus another illusion. That is to say, the idea of who you thought you were within your own mind compared to the idea that the world was telling you that you were. Neither one of them are true. What's occurred in your mind now is a complete alternative that, much to your surprise, delight, happiness, and gratitude, was not based on the solution you thought you could find at all. And the admission that all of your solutions have led you only to death and pain and loss have finally given you another direction in your own mind where the immediacy of the solution will be available to you. And I suppose I'm meandering a little bit within my own mind, but I want you to see in my certainty of the power of your mind to change your mind about who you thought you were. It's impossible that the immediate alternative the wholeness of you that will allow you to journey out into the universe, that will show you that we share the power of minds together that do not limit us to the factor of this old space-time that we thought we were. This is what this mind training is designed to do. And this is what this mind training is now beginning to accomplish within your own mind. We're going to take just a moment now if we can, because we're up to the idea that we are God thinking. Okay. We don't have to examine it, but because we know whatever thoughts we are having in our own mind, they cannot be excluded from the mind of God. In the simple admission, then, that our eternal Creator will not recognize us in our conflict in pain and death must be our solution, the solution offered to us by Jesus Christ, that you are whole and perfect as you were created. Now, we're going to share that moment of light together, and you are going to disappear beyond the veil, okay, of the defenses that you are releasing within your own mind, so you don't have to protect yourself from your own thoughts. Strange as it may seem to you, as a conceptual identity, you have been using the power of creative reality to make or invent an alternative within your own objective self and have justified it in your dream of death. That time has passed away. And we're sharing together now this moment of certainty that this is the place and the time that you always have intended to come to, but were fearful until this moment. We're fearful, literally, of the dark forms within your own mind, okay, that seem to be attacking you. The moment that you lay down that burden of identity, the light of heaven that is all around you right now, okay, began to shine on you. Are you ready? It's always been shining on you. Remember what we said? Okay, you can make dark forms and think they're real, but the light of God is going to be what you are in eternity. And as you leave this little location of space-time that contains all the evidence that there ever could have been in an idea of the invention of time within your own mind, you simply enter into a realm that was beyond any possibility of you recognizing. That's the realm that I'm offering you now with my mind, in the certainty that we share that single mind together. We call that love. And the love that I am expressing for you now has nothing to do with the judgmental procedure in which you based your reality. You are not what you thought you were. You are whole and perfect as you were created. I'm happy to see you now with this new evidence of what you must, will, and did become. Remember, we're back in time remembering this together. Remember that the organization in the new illusion that you are expressing is showing you an alternative that has always been available to you. It's the second part of your dream of death. It's the certainty that you, in fact, did depart here. And we're glad to see that you can see that now with us. So we'll be seeing you. And we hope that this adventure in space-time has led you to this point that while you may not be able to share it with a world that's objectified in this little frame of reference, you're beginning to have the experience, the insight of light within you that has given you the certainty of who you are. I'm glad you came with me, and I'm glad that you have let me and other teachers of God who are going out now into the world expressing the discovery of their own enlightenment, okay, and offering to you through forgiveness of each other certainty that you are whole and perfect as you were created. This is my offering to you. Okay. My certainty. Okay. That we came here for a moment and then left. How beautifully your Savior Jesus expresses it in the New Testament. He says very simply, everybody that ascends to heaven already came from heaven. You came here just for this moment in the idea of this sickness and pain, and it's being transformed now by this light that's all around you. What beautiful lessons they have been, that God is your source, God is your strength. The next lessons perhaps that we're going to do will say, God is the light with which we forgive each other and recognize in that moment of correspondence the truth of what we are. Thank you for your tolerance of allowing me to teach within your mind my certainty that we share this single reality. I'll see you very soon, and we'd like to hear from you. If in fact, okay, we can be of service in regard to this little blue book all about God and how to find them. Remember that this can be practiced by you anywhere you go in time. There's no doctrine in it. There's no necessity that you attend assemblages of political advantage. All of that will always be with you until you change your mind. What we're offering to you is the light that's contained within you. Okay. Can you see that with me? The certainty that you are the kingdom of God. And your kingdom now is becoming bright in the realization that you have assumed your role as the savior of this world, since you recognize that this world was caused by you in your own mind. We'll see you soon. Remember that God goes with us wherever we go, because God is the mind with which we think. I'll see you in just a moment.